cold, Jerry.
It's cold.
What I want to show on a tape here, Jimmy's here, this is one of his foam wings. Now if you look down the trailing edge, he joined this wing at home where he didn't have access to a really straight table. But if you look down the edge, I don't know if I can get this on, it's got a little bit of dihedral going up. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take the middle part of it here, and this is a good way to do it if you've never done this before, and just zone a saw. Jimmy's looking here like I'm going to... Right through. Oh, that sounds so good. I love the sound. Now I'm going to just take some, these are 64th plywood shims, and shove these in here until that trailing edge comes straight. Let's see if that'll do it. And once we get it straight, that looks about right. Well, if it doesn't, we'll put an extra one in. We'll epoxy that, let it dry, and then glass it. The glass does the work. That's just in there just to hold it in position while we're glassing it. It looks like it's going to need even three pieces. You know, it'd go a little bit further than we have to go. I'll make up another piece. It's going to settle back, and then when we put the... We'll put masking tape on the bottom, too, while we're doing this.
You put it over there.
Okay, there it is. I cut a piece of 32nd plywood to fit and shoved it down in there. You got the phone, Jim? Okay.
Fine job.
No, what it is, he said, he's not still there.
I'll try to go back there. They sounded like they're still playing on the phone.
If they're not, what else would you just... You just kind of...
Good question.
Crazy times.
I got a few places I can check with.
I mean, you got crazy skills that you could use. I'm just saying.
That's it. You just got to find a place that matches the craziness. That's all.
Yeah, I still don't... I guess you would know them because you could do it. I've never seen a couple like that.
Oh, there's a few. You go see with Brayton Jersey.
Really?
I work for 101 down at Plainview up 287. A couple more.
That likely got promoted to head of electrical engineering. He gave me a call. None of the guys down there are experts. They were dummies.
Okay, well, this is dry now. We let this dry. Now I want to check. I cleaned off all the extra alpha that I have a pretty straight. That looks pretty decent. Now what I'll do now is trim this off, sand this out, and this will be ready to glass. And by the way, that is a good way. That's an excellent way to get a ring back in true once it's a little bit... Even when you do it on a straight table, sometimes it'll twist up. Okay, we'll get this off, and then we'll Dremel tool the rest off. Trim this down. Get a Dremel on that last little bit, and we'll be ready to glass it. Did you bring glass cloth, or you want to use that stuff I have, Jim?
I didn't bring any.
Okay.
I
got some still in the drawer. Now, before glass in the middle of the wing, it's always important to get this sanded smooth. What happens if you have a high point and then you try to block sand this down, you make it weak where it should be the strongest. So
you cut the glass.
You cut the glass, right? At the point it should be the strongest. So when this is glass, we could lay out some tape the thickness of the body and not sand in here. Just let it in here stay just the way it is. That's a good way to do a foam wing, and it's a lot less work because you spend a lot of time sanding this bullshit, and you really don't have to. Nobody's going to see it inside the body. Now, that epoxy filled all in where we had that gouge. You would never know that now. And I would even guess if you were to go to try to break this wing, it's as strong now as it was before. I don't think it's any weaker than it was.
Like you said, you get no strength with this butt joint here, with what kind of glue you use.
The butt
glue in the foam?
You're glue in foam. How strong? It's only going to be as strong as the last piece of foam. Or a 16th piece of glass, end grain. How strong can it be?
Strength comes from the glass.
The glass. You go try to break glass when it's all laminated in. You forget about it. Okay, it all feels pretty good, Jim. We'll get the patterns and lay out the ellipses. Both sides look pretty good, huh? Yeah, that's thick line. The easiest way to make a little ellipse pattern, fold it, an IBM card over. This just acts to make it a little bit of a neater job than you normally would have. You can open it up, and now you have a half, not a critical thing, but a half neat way of laying it out. Where's that pen, Jimmy? I got it.
No, I want this one.
And what you do, just make, you're only interested in the high point of the wing. Everything else is nonsense except the high point. If you don't break the high point of the wing, you won't break anything. And just trace this around. This gives us a little layout. Nothing special here, just to, so we know we're not working in the dark. We can target this area. I'll mark the bottom, and then I'll make a smaller ellipse. We're going to do two ellipses here. So we have the same bolt hole, and you can use it that way. Reverse it this way. So we know it'll be pretty symmetrical, and just trace it out this way. Yeah, I've seen that.
It's all right, like a Vaseline.
The second ellipse, I'm just cutting maybe 3/8, a half inch away from the first ellipse. Get rid of that. Now you can use the inside of this as the pattern. And you can use these to lay out the glass cloth. Makes for a nice, neat job. And a centerpiece will just be a Band-Aid. And we have the two ellipses basically patterned out there.
It's only half-on stuff, right?
No, this is 0.75.
Oh, yeah?
Okay. Now, what I did, I laid out the same template on here with dots. So now we just go dot to dot to dot. We'll mix up some epoxy, glass this right up. I made up this strip or bandage for the middle, and we'll be ready. This one's really staticky. By the way, if you get it staticky like this, just put some static cling on it. That gets rid of that. And the whole thing is, of course, that use the epoxy. One tube is bigger than the other. Make the epoxy go out a little further than where you anticipate it to be. It's pointless to do anywhere much past, say, about here. The back of the wing is never going to split. But for sure, you want to get most of the glass on the high point and on the joint, the center joint and the high point, like an X. And if you do that, everything else is nonsense. Everything else is going along for a little bit of a ride. Okay, got the ellipses, Jim? Okay, got the big one. Let's see. We can kind of go dot to dot, which press the bolt in, do the fingertip routine, get that one knocked down. That's why having the dots there is real nice. It helps you line up a little bit onto the dots, gives you a little bit of a clue where you're going. You can take the second one. You can do this actually on one shot. If you want to be real cute, push the bolt in. See, without the dots, you would really have a tough time finding.
I'm sure without this music on, you couldn't do it either.
Oh, the music's got to go. That's George's favorite music.
Guys, a little culture.
You going, Craig?
Yeah, I
got to
get out of here.
Later, guy.
See you guys later.
Enjoy.
Okay. Where's the heat coming?
You remember the Beatles 60 years ago?
Turn the water. As soon as it turns to water, press it down. There it goes.
find something to start it off on. If you see air bubbles, you know you've gotten it too hot. Go out 20 fast where the glass ends and you won't have any trouble sanding it. Good enough. Going past the edge of that gym, so you can get the sandpaper, not to gouge into the wood at the end. Now, I assume we're going to tissue this over here and this one over, so otherwise I'd put more glass in the middle of the wing if you weren't going to tissue it. That double tissue under the body is definitely important. You don't want to leave that out, and you don't want to try to do it in one shot either. Or if you do, then double tissue it. Just wipe up any globos. You can get a tissue with some alcohol if you want, with the extra little globule. And if you're going to pull little hairs on the glass, let them go. Start somewhere in the middle and make a big starburst, big sunburst. There's hairs back here. They'll sand right out, but a little bit of alcohol. This is just ordinary isopropyl alcohol. Saves you a little bit of sanding. And we're going to put that Band-Aid piece in the middle, but if you can get the hairs to all go out in a sunburst, that's real nice. Now we still have to put that piece down the middle, so. You got the Band-Aid? Oh, here we go.
Need more goo down, or?
Yeah, we'll see. You can always put some more there. This is the thickness. It should fit just under the body. Doesn't have to be a perfect fit, but if we can get it to go, where the doublers are resting on our glass instead of resting on balsa wood, I think that would add a little bit of
it's a little narrow
strength. I just leave the front hang on there till we flip this over. Take a little bit of this goop.
Guess I can always put a couple extra strips of the thin stuff down with CA just for reinforcing under the body doubler.
I don't think it's critical. This is what's going to, if anything's going to break, it's going to be the middle of the wing. Just hold on to that thing. If this is just alcohol on a rig, this will just hopefully get the threads to come right out to the top so they'll sand right out the next day. Another trick, always let it dry minimum 24 hours, if you can another day or so, and that should powder right off. We'll do the other side off camera. It's just very redundant. In the middle where it really counts, you got three layers of glass. And that's about as light as
plus
I think you're going to make
plus
it.
The spar.
And if you double tissue this, and then over here, so you have double tissue down the middle, I think that's indestructible.
Now the best trick of all is, if you can, minimum time with this glass is to let it sit minimum 24 hours. Better, 48, best, even longer. The longer the better. And that should sand out. Double tissue, it should be perfect. That's a real nice job.
Just
Now let's hear the truth. This top block started out at 54.
Just under 44 and a half now.
It's 44 and a half now.
And it's going to come down.
Chris Weller here.
Yeah, the tape is on.
Andy Lee. George is over there having a heart attack.
Okay.
Don't bother me.
I am still not here.
You can have all you want. You can eat until you die. So what's the deal? We're going to get this top block hollowed down to 2 ounces tonight?
No,
this is the heaviest top block. Now listen, Jimmy, this is true. This is no bullshit. Show everybody what Jimmy was doing before. Jimmy was trying to hollow the top block with a pizza crust.
That is right.
Jimmy, show him your technique for hollow. Look at this shoe. Look at this big foot over here.
Someone took it. I don't know where
somebody
it
took it.
Somebody ate it.
Somebody ate my sanding block.
Oh, no. He was using various grits of pizza crust. Look, he's still got hold it. Let's get it on the macro lens.
Ed Gallagher failed to get up with the tail block there. See, it's perfect.
It's recessed. We even had Vic Macaluso towing the tree. I guess we're
so
past
else
that
you
want
to
today.
You haven't seen these people in a while.
Oh, man. Let's get busy. Okay, I'll on this top block. No fun on Monday night here.
Muff Graham.
Here you go.
I gotta tell you, we really had an unbelievable session here last night. It was really a special one. What I want to do now, I'm gonna go over by George's and see how big Tsunami's coming out. But first thing I want to do, I want to pull off all this tin foil. Now, a couple of tricks, and these tricks will be very, very helpful. Is pull a tape slowly and pull it straight back. Always best to let the paint dry at least 24 hours and turn it perfectly straight back, pull it right back against itself and pull it slow. Now I'll go right down 1-to-1, not gonna pull a lot of this on tape. And then I'm gonna card off all the edges once I get all the paper off. Straight back and slow. The slower you pull a tape back, the less chances you'll pull up some of the substrate. Now with all the tape off of here, one of the last things I'm going to do here in this session, I have a credit card with a sharp edge. They're not sharp when Karen gets done using them. Sharp edge, one that your wife hasn't melted down yet. You see how that stuff is coming right off? Shaves it right off. You just rotate. Get each edge. The little fuzzy edges get knocked right down if you're patient. It'll save you a lot of a ridge that normally has to get buried and clear. You get a lot of that ridge right down.
And in less than a decade, 36-40.
Another thing while I'm removing tape and knocking edges down, I want to pull off the tape of all the canopy edges and knock this down.
On
the edge of the Rhine McCutcheon at Frankfurt. The Zeppelin Company was involved in race for Tsunami. No. We didn't have any fear. Get off any rough edges here. All the edges seem pretty good. And the next time we get to work on this, we'll try to get into black stripes and maybe even roundels on the side. But for now, it's good night. Give them a kiss, good night. Hug them, kiss them.
Now this morning, what I wanted to lay out was these, the little stripes here. I like to get this paint dry enough. I'm just going to lay this out rough, since the only thing I need to paint is the white bar. I can just get this roughly put in. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to put this piece in here. This is not a piece that comes out. Now I can put tape on both sides and then pull this piece out, and that'll be the white bar that pretty much have the alignment that I want. That's why it's nice to have these little patterns ahead of time. Makes doing this relatively simple, and most of all, it makes it accurate. Okay, now there's the piece I need to have right there. Okay, now what I want to do is transpose this down onto the other side so I can look right from the top and then get all these alignments from the back. And I'll make sure I have an exact mirror image. I'm looking down to make sure they're both parallel and they both end at the same spot here. Nothing would look worse than if these were up, down. Getting them so this bar is the one that you're going to see, the white one. That one's going to stand out like a sore thumb, especially if it's wrong. Just double checking. Okay, that's ready to spray, and while that's spraying, I'll be out of here. While that's drying, give that some time to dry, and we'll get to work on this, I hope, tonight. See, this is just one thing. I have a little bit of time in the morning before I head out of here, and I like to get even one little thing done, even if it's like my time management program. If I can get one little thing done, if I get back tonight, tonight's Craig's birthday. I'm not going to work on it tonight, but the next time I get to work on this, even just having one little thing done, I start to catch up on this. Instead of being behind a little bit every day, I'm either equal or ahead. So I'm just going to spray this now, and then I'm out of here. I'm on my way to George's. Extra time. Yeah, I got this. Actually, got this painted. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to mask off where the white is on the radiators while I have a little extra time. It's amazing. They're predicting another snowstorm for this weekend, so I'm going to try to get. I'm actually putting a push on to try to get some of these white stripes and stuff painted today, and maybe get the tape off tonight, hoping that maybe I can beat the storm a little bit here. Is these will automatically now become the left radiator and the right radiator because of the way they're painted. So I'm trying to get that tape, get a really nice lining up the bolt hole here, but I want to get it, in other words, this is what I don't want to have, is where that stripe doesn't line up. So what I'm going to do is just stick the bolt in temporarily, make sure I have that perfect alignment here, otherwise that stripe's going to be crooked one way or the other. One thing is for sure, I guarantee you this. After this tape is on, after this mask is on, I'm going to put these little screws back in and make sure these stripes line up. Because if they don't, boy, is this going to look dumb. And I'm sure everybody will see it. Everybody will be going, get the stripes straight, get the stripes straight. So, anyway, Joe, if you do the same invasion stripes that I'm doing, they'll come out right here. I thought they were going to come out right in the middle of a radiator. No way, Jose. So if they were right in the middle, you'd even notice it even more, but they're off to one side. So at least you got a little handle to hold this while you're painting it, too. So now I'm even making a line straight on the bottom. no reason, just so, you know, if somebody picks up the plane or takes the, we take these scoops off and somebody looks at them, they'll say, oh boy, that's even painted on the bottom where you don't see it. Okay, is it ready to spray? And that definitely will be it for today. Now, a couple of thoughts here. I've already put plenty of cleaning the spray gun on this, but here's one thing you really want to remember. Now, this is a gun that had silver in it at one time, one of the old guns. If you ever have silver in a gun, and you're going to put black, which is what I'm going to put the black in here, because I want to leave the white in the gun so I can have both of them in the gun at the same time. When I take the silver out of the gun, there's always some little silver that stays in the bottom. So what's a good idea is I take some black paint, mix it with a lot of thinner and spray it through the gun a few times. Try to get out all those little flakes of silver, because what happens, in black especially, what'll happen is some of those little flakes, it'll look like there's dust in the paint, and you won't see it until you put the clear on. So what I'm going to do, and I'll do it off camera, of course, I'm going to take this gun completely apart and get all of the silver dust out of it, clean it, get it ready, mix the black, same thing, Flexol, fisheye. Black is one of the few colors I don't even bother adding extra pigment to. It covers pretty good the way it is, but if you ever have silver in a gun and you're going to paint black, which is exactly what I'm going to do right now, clean the thing immaculately. Those little silver flakes, nothing looks worse. You won't notice them until you buff it out, you put it in the sun, and say, there's dust in the paint. It winds up looking like dust. That's a good tip, too.
All right, Venturini, let's see what you got done since the last time we had tsunami, right? Yeah, oh, you got the scoop on.
You want tip for sanding blocks? Roll of tape?
Well, yeah. Jimmy was sanding with pizza last night. I couldn't believe it. Pizza crust and sticky back sandpaper. Hey, by the way, talk about good tips. This is a good one. When you hit the edge of the glass working on this.
You know why I say it? Because there's a big ding under it.
So what are we going to work on today? We're going to sand this guy out or what?
Going to sand that scoop in and fit in?
Yeah, yeah. Look at the size of this thing.
I cut this out.
You got the cowling, Pete? Put that in here. You got to make some 60-foot plywood edges for here and stuff? Yeah, we can work on that today. Where's the motor? Nice motor, in case you need a motor for your snowblower or something. Unbelievable. I like this screening. Where'd you get that screening? That's what I need for inside.
It's a piece of screening I laid around.
Door screening?
Yeah,
I need that for inside the Spitfire, inside that radiator hole.
My wife's cooking was so bad that the whole of the skin.
Well, look at this. We have genuine Bob Martens sanding blocks here. Hey, Martens, just believe me. Anybody's into RC. I know Gallagher's into RC. All our potential RC fly. This thing will fly, believe me. More paintings. How'd those guys like your shop last night?
They seem to like it.
You got a kick out of it? Yeah, I know that guy Andy, he likes stuff like this. Look at all these paintings. All kinds of GBs. All right, GBs. Anyway, we got to get to work here. George is a tough boss to work for. Skyline.
Yeah, 14 in New York.
Oh my God. Guy's a hard boss to work for. He's going to work me like a dog today. Here's his latest painting. You try painting those gauges. Now, the first thing today you notice, we got to put edges on all this. This is kind of a rough cutout. So what I did, I sanded this on a piece of sandpaper, got the edges nice, put some 64th plywood edges in here, left them oversized, and when I'm all finished doing this, I'll dremel all these off so it'll be nice and flat. But that makes it nice and rigid. Now you got a nice rigid thing. And when we set that in, then what I'm going to do, I'm going to set that in position, sand it, set it in position, then put the plywood that goes on this side right up against there, and then fill that in with CA so that the joint will be perfect all around. It'll be much, if not perfect, it'll be a lot better than it is right now. Now I block sanded this right in. This would be a trick you absolutely could use on any model, stunt ship, RC model, anything. get those edges nice, the nice plywood edges. Now what I'm going to do is take this piece, I guess I put this on before, and you can see how ratty all these edges are from sawing into it. Well, with this piece in now, George is making up the mount right now. Now I can drop a piece of plywood right in here. I'll rough sand these out, give me a little clearance. Drop that plywood right in there, and that first piece will line that right up. I'll obviously get a new piece, but that'll be that should be nice edges, and then we can block sand this whole thing right in and get the holes cut. Maybe even get them today if you get that motor mount finished, the hole cut for the motor. By the way, one of the things we still want to do too, we want to get this blending, and the way we'll do that is put masking tape over this and then blend it and keep replacing the masking tape. So we just have the thickness of masking tape to take, and when it's right, just take this off and then final sand it in. All right, now we got these pieces sitting in here. The cowling is actually pressing them into position, but the whole outline is now 64th plywood, and that cowling is the jig that holds it in position. Once this dries up, we'll even up the seams with some thick CA and then Dremel that right off. And we can block sand the whole thing in, and we'll have all our edges. Well, it should be very nice and neat in one stroke of the pen. And that is really a trip worth its weight in gold. While I'm mentioning tricks, one of the things you might want to do at some point in time if you have a little bit too much clearance is just take an extra piece of 64 plywood and shove that in, and that'll give it a little pressure back, front, up, down, whichever, so it'll squeeze that right into position. And when you look at some models and they have those perfect edges and you wonder, how did that guy do that? Oh, how did he do it? Well, yeah, there's a lot of tricks to it, and I hope this is one you can use. Now while that little guy is drying up, and you can see how nice those edges are, let that dry up. We're actually making up the motor mount. George is making it up. I'm mixing up the glass, the resin in here, and I'm going to lay in, ooh, that's nice and gooey now. I'm going to lay in some 6-ounce cloth right in there so that when we do cut the hole for the motor and exhaust, mufflers, whatever, we'll have some integrity in whatever the edges are. Then I want to bring the cloth up around all the edges if I can. Just to build it so it's like it has a little strength, like a little fillet around all the edges. Alright, there's the cowling with the 6-ounce cloth inside. That's ready. While that's drying up, give that an hour or so to just kick off. I'll go over and work on the seams on the main part of the frame, and we got to put the bulkhead in. It's going to hold the motor. Back from George's, I got all the tin foil off now, scraped down the edges. I wanted to put one little tip here. This will be a big help to you.
Get this on the macro lens. When I was pulling up the tape, and this will typically happen at the edge, you get a little tiny piece of paint lifting right down to the raw wood or whatever. This was the only one here so far. I just rub it with little Q-tips. Thin CA, put it right on the Q-tip, rub it, and then rub it with a dry, get it off of there before it kicks.
Now these are ready actually to paint the black, so I'll use these four parts I can back mask. Use these for testing the black to make sure I have all the silver out of the gun and everything. That gun is still cooking away there. I want to get that clean, and I want to hopefully run a little test on this before the end of the night. Now I'm ready to mix up the black. I poured, what the hell is this now? Pine? I don't even know. I'm lost. 8 ounces of black. What I'll do, I don't add any extra pigment to black. 8 ounces of black, 8 ounces of thinner, a little bit of flex oil, a little bit of fisheye. I'll mark the batch and run a little test. And that should be pretty close to 50-50, maybe a little more thinner. I always put the thinner back in the can and shake it out. This way you get the last little bit of pigment out. That'll pretty much be ready to go. A little bit of flex oil. They say there's flex oil in dope. Yeah. A little extra. Why take a chance? Anyway, I'll always use a little part for a test. Drop a fisheye killer. You're all set. And that sucker is ready to go. Now, once I get this mixed, I hope this is going to be, you know, I bought 2 cans of this. I hope this is going to be enough. Black usually covers so well, and the only thing you can do bad with black is leave a little bit of silver in a gun.
We'll go out and give this a little test. Looks a little on the thick side. I'm guessing that's going to need a little bit of thinner. We'll find out.
Well, what I did, and maybe Joe can pick this up off the video for his too, I didn't want to have it where the stripe, the paint of the stripe goes right through the scoop and out the other side. So what I did, I brought it up almost to the end. Let me get
some macro lens.
Right up to the edge so that the lip, the actual mouth here, will be black. And the white will just go within a 16th of an inch of that. So for any, you know, I can just picture what that would be like, trying to paint inside a radiator white. Definitely would not be cool. But anyway, one of the things I've been, and I'll just mention this, so I've been having good, I had this old roll of this yellow masking tape, and it seems to work okay. I don't know why I use it, I just started using it because it was 1/4 inch wide and I was measuring with it. But it really does leave a nice paint edge, so, and there's a true story here, it was a funny thing. Mention this real quick, the guy that sells this stuff commercially is in our club in the Circle Burners, and one day at a meeting, I didn't know he was the one that sold the stuff. And he was showing it off, and he says, oh, how do you like this, how do you like this? And I said, that stuff is shit. I used it, and it pulls off the paint or something. It's something embarrassing. And the guy never spoke to me since then. He still hates me. I guess I don't get any Hall of Fame vote from him. Tough.
Now, one of the things that I've been thinking about, it's difficult to get the spray to go right inside there. And of course, it's going to be difficult if we use these radiators even to wipe them off. So I'm being real careful. I want to get plenty of paint inside there. And I don't want to paint it with a brush. I don't want to have brush marks. So I've been painting the lip. Paint right over that little touch-up area. Losing a light here, it's already dark. Boy, if only everything comes like black. Get inside here painted.
You can see how nice that covered, boy. That is really nice. And today, a couple of real... These are the kind of things you find out in the real world. Remember this old yellow tape? Now, this is an old roll, and somewhere earlier in this video, I said, I told the guy at the club meeting or whatever that his tape was shit, never use it. Well, I forgot why it was shit. I just remembered, I took the tape off of here, and it left a yellow residue. I'll show this on a macro lens. Wherever there was yellow tape, there's now a yellow residue on the white paint, so I'm going to have to back mask this and paint it. Yellow tape. See, this is what happens. You really always want to be creative and try as many new things as possible, but when it comes time, when push comes to shove, you don't need that aggravation. Also, another thing, I don't know, and you see in TV behind me, I finally got Midgley to send me some tape of making canopies, and he sent this great, you know, I have 20-minute video up here or whatever of life in New Hampshire. You know, these woodchucks that live up in New Hampshire don't have telephones and outdoor plumbing and stuff, indoor plumbing. But anyway, he has a little tour. I'm sure you'll be thrilled when you see, and actually showing how to make canopies, which even I never saw. So hope you don't mind that footage. But there's one final thing. This is absolutely unbelievable. I watched last night on Channel 13 on Nova, a program called Nova. We get in New Jersey. It's a public television about a show that they call B-29 Frozen in Time,
and I managed to get a clean copy of it, a professional copy, so I can use it. And anybody out there that has missed that show or not seen Nova, B-29 Frozen in Time, I don't want to tell you what it's about, but if you like World War II airplanes and you like, I guess the things I like is the best word, you don't want to miss it, and I'll loan you a first-rate copy, not one that's copied off a TV set, a real first-rate copy. So if you just tell me, and the next time I ship out tapes to you, I'll ship a copy of that out. You can check it out. This canopy stuff is interesting. The tape's now going into the barrel, you know, into the use it for something else barrel. Again, this is what you learn. This is how you learn. There's no such thing as going to college and I'm going to take a course in tapeology. It doesn't work. You've got to do some fooling around to figure it out. But anyway, it did leave a yellow residue. It really aggravates me that I forgot about that. But, you know, when you're 50 years old, you forget. Hey, I forget sometime who I'm married to. I'm in a go-go bar and I, oh, Karen who, you know? Just kidding, Karen. Okay, serious stuff. I want to get back to the paint job. I pulled this apart. I'm going to card the edges down. I want to get the invasion stripes. I'll put this tape from Dave, instead of putting it in the middle here, I'm going to put it on the beginning of the next tape. Check it out and write Dave a letter, tell him thanks. It's really good information. It's really something a lot of modelers, I wouldn't say a lot, the majority of modelers don't know how to make a canopy. So I think that's kind of interesting. And if we ever get back into, in this event, into where modeling itself is a highly respected thing instead of surfboards and ironing boards and tuned pipes and everything, I think that kind of information will be valuable, so use it. Now, even this, I'm even taking some Gorham's and trying to get that yellow stain off to maybe try to not have to repaint the white. Forget it. Got to repaint the white. We're fooling around with this. Sometimes, another trick, there is some little spots of overspray on here. If you do get little oversprays, Gorham's. Don't sand it. Sanding leaves scratches. The Gorham's, and sometimes if it's small, Gorham's and a Q-tip. Now, I thought this was going to come right out. You know, it just shows you. And when you're done with the Gorham's, of course, wipe it with M600. This yellow tape. Now, obviously, this would not be a problem if you were painting black, putting a tape. But if you're going to put the yellow tape on white, be aware it can be a problem. The dye in the tape or the glue or whatever it is. And boy, this is the kind of stuff. See, one of my philosophies is, I'm such a cheap bastard, I save everything. Because I always figure, some kid will come in and I can paint his guitar or bicycle, or we can tape off the aluminum siding on a house or something. I never throw things away. This is something should have been thrown away. See, I didn't throw it away now. 2 years from now, you'll see a video. Windy building the B-29 and that same goddamn tape's going to ruin a paint job. So anyway, learn a lesson. Don't live like I do. Anyway, this stain, I'm going to show this on the macrons. This did not come off. I don't know if you can see that.
Now, I don't really know if on the video you can see the yellow stain. I can see it anyway. It's irrelevant. I wouldn't want to put, you know, that on my Spitfire, so I will backmask this. Luckily, what's nice is I still have the white in the gun, so I can redo it. But, and it's, these are just the kind of things I like to share, because it obviously saves people time, energy, money. Now, one thing nice, when you paint one side and paint the other side, there's no step here in the paint. The paint is almost perfectly flat. So when you put clear over this, it'll be almost flat to begin with. It's not like when you paint one on top of the other and then you have that step. So, but of course, that requires real careful masking. But, you know, this is one of those things where I'm just going to go back to what I know works every time. Was a good experiment, and less than perfect results. But by sharing it with you, I hope I can save you some aggravation.
So, you know, I make a personal point of every time I make a mistake, when I redo it, catalog in my brain that, hey, Wendy, you used to be a young guy with a good memory, now you're not, so you have to pay the price. So I'm going to go out and spray this off camera. And that thing literally did. By the way, that is really good information. He's not a great commenter. He doesn't have much of a sense of humor, and from what his wife said, he's not really a real man. But that's okay. We share the information with you. We're glad. If you have some good ideas, like Ed Gallagher's been contributing ideas, Bob Martens,
please contribute. Please share what you know. None of us know everything there is to know, and none of us know nothing. And if we share it, we'll all know more. Lesson of the day, and lesson two, don't use yellow tape.
Funny, after watching Newbury's thing with all the snow in New Hampshire, we're back, it's snowing again today. I'm going to start doing my spray today.
So yeah, this is one of the reasons it's real nice to have the gun that still has the white in it if I have to touch up. This is a good spot to mention to you another thing that I've had happen to me more than once. You ever paint anything red and then you try to paint white on top of it or some shades of blue, just bleeds through forever. The only way you get around it is auto primer. The only thing I've found that can block out red is a nice big thick coat of auto primer. Anyway, we don't have that much on these, but I don't know if you can see it on the macros. That would aggravate me to death that yellow was on it. A lot of people wouldn't even bother them, but bothers me. Here's another, trying to put as much of this information on a tape as I can. Even though I've painted this and it looks relatively white now, what's a good idea is to let it sit overnight by a heating vent and see if the yellow bleeds through. If it does, the next trick obviously is I'll have to order. Why take all the tape off when I don't know if this is going to be good enough? What I'd have to do then is either put, maybe silver would even work. Maybe I ought to run a test on silver, but I know auto primer will block it out. Hopefully, and I can even see where the yellow came, it's bleeding through, so I'm going to let this sit up by the heating vent before I even take the tape off in case I have to hit this again.
Now what always seems a problem for some people, we have the white paint on and I want a back mask. I want a back mask over the white so only the silver is shown, but I want to get that tape right on the line, and there's a couple of things that'll make it easier. First off, whether it's curved or straight. One thing makes it easier is a lot of practice, but you can see as I'm putting the tape down, and I'm just trying to simulate this, I'm wiggling it back and forth real easy so I can just keep seeing that line reappearing. I'm just giving it I want to see it right on a line, right on a line, right on a line. Now what's nice, obviously I've abandoned that yellow tape, is the 3M striping tape is kind of see-through, you can see the line, but I don't think there's any real substitute for just practicing. And what I do constantly is back and forth till I just see it, and then pull it down. And I guess it's just from doing this for, a lot of years that I've managed to develop a little bit of a technique, but that's it. Now, where the two tapes join, one of the things you can do, and it'll help, is you can slit it right at the tape. Otherwise, there's a little tunnel that that paint can run under. I'm going to seal this with a very thin coat of clear, very small amount, but this certainly will be, that's one way to deal with that little tunnel effect. Well, one of the tricks you can use, tips, tricks, whatever, it's always, no matter what trim scheme you have what I call islands. Now, our roundels are going to be islands, or these stripes are going to be islands, and they're kind of isolated little things you need to mask off. Now, if you tried to cut the aluminum foil, the exact size, it would be bullshit. It would be here all day. So what I try to do is tear the tape even with the end. This is one trick. A lot of people spend a lot of time backmasking. It really shouldn't be a big deal. It should be kind of shut, cut and dry. Now you can see this piece is obviously too big. But if you have tape on both ends, you can kind of just fold it back just a little bit. I'm trying to do this and look down at the camera. Okay, if you lay that, now you have your island, let's call it an island, set in place. Now you can just, as you go around the front, you can just fold
the extra tinfoil and you got a perfect mask. And as you go around, you can do the same thing. You can set one side in, lay it down, set the other side in, let it hang over on both sides, doesn't matter. As long as the tin foil is an inch or two bigger than what it has to be, well, you can pinch it up at the front, pinch it up here. Tin foil doesn't bleed like newspaper does. You can even squeeze it in the middle. Bring it right around, do the same thing up here, do the same thing up here. It makes that back, that job of back masking, which usually is pretty time consuming, if you're using slices. I know, in the beginning, I used to try to take slices of newspaper and stuff and get them all, just all the angles and shapes, get the tape, just mask it off. I used to dilly-dally and try to be fancy, and I'd say, oh, somebody's coming over the house, I gotta show them how nice I can back mask. Baloney. Just back mask. And that's one of the, now when we do the roundels, they'll be exactly the same technique. When they get oversized, overlap it, just pinch the ends stay pinched relatively quick. Good technique.
The next thing I need to do is I need to lay out my striping and where the roundels are going to go so I can back mask that area there. And I haven't really made a final decision on this yet. I have to make up some patterns for the roundels and lay out the striping. Now here's where it really pays to have all the patterns made up ahead of time and know where you're going to have to do your line separation and everything. What's also nice is having these roundels already made up. Now I can start laying out and cutting my patterns for the roundels.
Now this is where it really pays to have these patterns, because I can measure. Now this is going to be the white stripe, which includes the tape, the black stripe, the white stripe. And you can see I've done these over and over again to get them. I want to get them straight up. Believe me, this takes more time than you think it does to make perfect stripes around a decreasing radius body here. But again, I can just check any spot that these are off, I can trace and make an adjustment to the tape. And remember, these the black ones always have the tape on the inside, in this case, always have it on the inside.
Now I just tried to estimate what diameter I want here. This is Friskit paper. Buy this at an auto supply store. The trick is, if you can, cut over newspaper. Try to get it off in one piece and then try to get a brand new razor under it. One little spot it didn't go through. This is just going to be an outside mask anyway, so it doesn't really matter. Now, of course, one of the things that I want to make sure is I have these, when you look from the top or the bottom, they're the same amount forward and the same amount. So when I stand here, one isn't higher or lower, they both kind of meet at the same point. The nice thing about Friskit paper, if you use Friskit paper, you can move these 100 times before they really get to be where the paint will bleed under them. And needless to say, a little coat of clear there helps all the bleed out, but it really, even that is, doesn't matter. We're going to ultimately space these out in yellow, and the yellow, that's when we'll get the edge that we really have to seal it up tight. I just ready to mask off and I guess paint them.
Hmm.
Okay, you got the flaps up here that the black part's drying, the black on this drying. Really good. This has been a real cold. It is real. More snow. Midgley, I know you'll love it.
Oh boy, this stuff dries up so nice up by the heating vent. There's only one problem we run into. We got the heating bill today. It was about three times the normal amount of heat. But you know what? Hey, you only go around once, you know? You only get to fly the B-29 once, so gonna have to pay the bill here. Buy some more tape so I can afford to keep the heat going all winter. I guess with the black and white contrast, you can see how the edges come right down. Now, if there was a little spot, and there probably is on here somewhere that I'm not happy with, there's a real easy way to fix it. You have a choice with black. You can always just, up here it's lousy, get an ink pen. And this is always better if you let it dry a day and then shave it. An ink pen is always a good idea. Or you can just get a little tiny touch-up brush and touch these edges up. Now, because this has been painted twice, it's kind of, it's about as white as anything on earth. I'm just running a little test here to see if this paint is dry enough. Yeah, it looks okay. You get a nice clean break edge, it's probably dry enough. Now those are the things right there, is what I'm trying to show. Those are the things when they're soft like this. This really hasn't dried 24 hours. This is kind of soft. Let it harden up before you knock it off. See those little paint lines when they're soft like this, they really don't want to come off nice and neat. This is probably right on the verge of being a little too soft to even take off. How's also, where's that little spot? I gotta look. How's that little spot? Yeah. Had a little spot. And what I do, I try to touch this up in an ongoing basis. So I'll get the brush out, put a little dot of white there, and just let it. What you can see, this is where the black was. But little tiny spots like that where the finish comes up is not the end of the world. You're gonna bury this in clear and sand it and buff it out anyway. So why even worry about it? Shaving the edges is important though. What happens if you leave this edge up real high, especially where it's double masked, and you get clear and it melts the edge and then, ugh, terrible. See, I just want to try to keep it after this. If you do this kind of touch-up on an ongoing basis at the end of the plane, you never wind up with something that's a real big problem. You do a little bit each day. And almost every plane I've ever had, you get a couple of spots where the paint, usually whatever the reason is, your fingers are greasy or whatever. I can look around too, any spots that just don't look so good. That looks pretty good. Is right on the verge of being too soft. I really should wait till tomorrow, but you know how it is. I have a little time left here tonight. I think I get this all pulled off. Let's see the thing I wanted to show. This is just plain old brooms, and I have little spots of overspray on here. Brooms and a Q-tip, and just go gently and take them right off.
There was another one on here somewhere. I was looking.
Typically, it'll be on white. The white is the hardest to keep clean.
It's true, I jumped on the radio.
Can I step close it right there? That is a really good trick.
So stop asking. No, no more. Can't keep living with the guilt.
Stop, Titty. What's your language?
Oh, cut the crap. Bring on the beat.
Bust that pod wide open.
Eddie, I come with you.
No, it's me that got us into this. I'm the one to get us out. Wait for me, Audrey. This is between me and the vegetable. Any household in America, thousands of you eating. That's what you had in mind all along, isn't it?
No shit, Sherlock.
We're not talking about one hungry plant here. We're talking about world conquest.
And I wanna fight you.
You're not gonna get away with this. Your kind never does.
Trying to get all the touch-ups done here before I go over to the other panel.
Now wait a minute. You gotta pull the phone. Don't mind your mouth. You're gonna change your tone. Don't you threaten me, son. You got a lot of gold. We're gonna do things my way. Only gonna do things at all. You in trouble now.
Spot for the roundel.
Again, I'm just cleaning up all the final little touch-ups and clean-ups here, and that's going to be it for tonight. It's been an exciting... You'll see, when you use a lot of extra pigmented white, it tends to pick up all the little spots from the tin foil, things like that, but it'll come right out with the Gorham's. The Gorham's seems to be the best material to take this off on.
Well, at the end of every session, I like to piece it together. After getting all the little touch-up spots in there, get a little look at how it's shaping up. This was a pretty long day, but you know, at the end of any day like this, you like to see some results, and this is finally, with the invasion stripes on there, it's really starting to have that look, so give me something to think about tonight while I'm sleeping.
Today, I had this hanging overnight up by the heating vent here, and believe me, I've been very generous with the heat. I wish I had heat like this during the non-construction period. But anyway, while it's painting, while I'm in this painting mode, I really have had the heat in the house higher than normal, and the bill reflects that. Anyway, I wanted to put it in this dimension. I wanted to get the overall look, how this is going to look from far away, in an overhead 8 and whatever, and I think these invasion stripes are really going to show up well, so really kind of happy with the way this worked out. I'm going to start laying out the roundels today. I did all the touch-ups yesterday. I'm going to check that they're all, as reasonable as can be. Now I get busy with my other stuff, getting ready to do the roundels.
Now what I've been doing, I've been playing with the positioning of these. Of course, I have the big roundels and the small roundels. The ones on the bottom have a yellow band on the outside and a white band, unlike the top ones. So I've been kind of moving these around and doing this positioning thing. I want to figure out exactly where I want this to be. And even though it sounds insignificant, it sounds like something, you don't have to do that. Yeah. Well, it is a significant thing. I really want to have this that it's as scale-like as possible, without being, ridiculous looking. Now what I noticed, and this is an optical illusion, to make this more scale-like, this almost touches the front, but we're going to have a yellow band across here. So I'm moving this a little further back than I normally would. And what I noticed is, remember this dimension here is a difficult one. This is how it would be if we were making a scale model. It would be almost up on the front. But you know what? I don't like the way that looks. For some reason, it doesn't look right. You know, it's right if it was a scale model. So again, this is the kind of thing I'm thinking about. If I line up the middle of the roundel with the hinge, the break in the hinge, it seems to look better. I don't know if the people, if you can see this on a video. It seems like the kind of thing to be right, it has to be wrong. So again, I'm going to do this off camera. I'm going to play around with this, make an exact position that I want these in, and I'm going to get out the Frisket paper and start cutting out the roundels for the bottom of the wing.
Now, one of the problems of cutting, and I'm anticipating this, I don't know this yet. This is the Frisket paper that Ed Gallagher sent. One of the problems is when you want to cut concentric circles, and it's round L, the bottom one anyway is going to be several concentric circles. One of the problems is you want to pull a first circle out and be able to cut the next one, and the next one, and not have the thing move. Once you lose, for instance, if you have the compass here and you cut the middle out, the paper moves, then you've got not a concentric circle. If you can picture in your mind how this would work, well, I can't really picture it in my mind because I've never done this yet. But what I want to do is share the experience of learning this. Let me get that roundel over there. And if you can see some of the mental steps I've gone through. Now what Ed suggested, and it's on that note, is to glue this down with spray cement. I think that's a good idea. But I'm going to try one, and this will be something we can share on a video. I'm going to at least give this a try with taped edges. If it doesn't work, then I'll obviously go right to the contact cement and quit fooling around. Now I want to get, and I'm guessing this would be smart to do the smallest size, the small one first. Again, this is the size I ultimately want to wind up with.
So let me figure this out. One is going to fit. You know what? It's not going to fit on a piece of paper. Okay, how can we do away with that? We can take the tape out of here. See, these are the things you figure out. You think you're so smart.
Well, if you see what's involved,
and excuse me for thinking out loud, but this is one of the things you have to improvise a little bit. And one of the things I consider that I'm relatively good at anyway. Not many things, by the way, but I am good at improvising. And if I just don't have the tape here, again, somebody out there probably will just go to the contact cement, but one of the things a lot of people think of is they think, oh, this certain expert flyer or this certain guy, whoever your local hero is, he never has any problems. Well, you know what? The truth is, he probably has as many or more problems than you, but he doesn't want to share them. So I can tell you firsthand, I have problems. Now that, see, that'll fit. That'll be perfect. And just let me do this. Let me see if I can position that. I really have to do the top the same way. Let me see if I can do this. I'll do the same thing. Let me do it off camera. I'll do the same thing up top so I can get the whole roundel out of one piece. Now let's just see if this is a reasonable way. You think the paint job on this plane is real easy. Ah, it's just roundels and invasion. Yeah, do it. Well, let me tell you, it is not that easy. Now, I need to figure out, I want to make everything a quarter of an inch. Where's my machinist ruler? Man should be a little more prepared than this. I want to make this exactly a quarter of an inch. So I can reset the compass now. See, this is where it gets tricky, is this is the circle I want. I want this circle right here. Okay, two down. Well, not quite down. That's two. Now I want to cut the big circle. Let's go right out to within a quarter of an inch of the end. A quarter of an inch. Okay. There we go. Well, so far so good. And believe me, I never erase the tape. If something isn't right, by the way, this is one of those postage boxes, which I thought would be a good thing to use. Even if you contact cement, if we contact cement down, we'll use the postage box. This is a good cutting medium. And if you don't have one of these, just go down to the post or order something and I'll send you. What a businessman. Okay, now I need to get this out a quarter of an inch. And if I can get this last circle cut reasonably, this will probably be the one that's difficult. Now this is only the bottom roundel, so, okay. You know what, before I cut that, let me tape it just to hold it. See, otherwise the thing is not going to be concentric. Let's see where I wind up over here. Actually, you have to do this real accurate. I'm sure Joe can pick up some ideas since anybody building a British plane. Hey, if the Julia builds another one of those mosquito bombers, better get his ass busy. He's building a new shop, you know. He said he's going to build models of the British Air Force. Okay, see, now it's a problem. Now it's starting to... I may have to cut this one over. Yeah, it is a problem. This is kind of off-center here. Okay. I'll have to cut this ring separately. This is not a usable one here. But this is the stuff you learn. Let's see if we can, just for laughs, see if we can salvage it. No. Okay, so maybe we do have to contact cement it down. Okay. Now this one, see, that was the reason. So Ed, you're right. Wendy is wrong, you're right. The next one I do, and I'll do this off camera. I'm gonna spray cement this and glue it right down, and I'll have four usable, ready to go roundels. Well, one of the thoughts is I can just turn this over. I can use this side. Yeah. So for one priority box, you get two. I'm gonna go spray this off camera. I'll do it outside, that spray cement. Okay, I sprayed this up with some contact cement. And we'll give this one a try. So cold out there, the cement doesn't even want to dry. Let's try and dry it outside. Not a realistic idea. Okay. Okay, in the evolutionary process, I figured out a couple of things that'll make this a lot easier for you. And of course, Ed the painter probably knows already. I tried doing one with spray contact cement. And what happened, because this is a double box, it's kind of springing and moving, and I slipped with the compass. So that was one gone. And then I wound up trying to be cute. I tried to do one without tape around the edge, and I slipped up at the end. Well, that didn't work so good. So what I'm going to have to do is make the roundel just a little bit smaller that it fits on this paper. This one was the original one, so I've done three already. Probably going to run out of Frisket paper. But the first thing is I'm going to get this nice and flat to the ground. That one of the problems is that I ran into is this was spongy. So what I want to do is I want to take this. I'll put the spray cement on here. Good old same stuff you use for foam wings. Spray this, and I'm going to tape this right down nice and flat before I do the next cut. Now my motive in trying all this stuff is not to try to outsmart or prove that I'm right or whatever other people. Because I need to find out what method is going to work well for me. And I want to pass that on. Now, two other Spitfires are tentatively under construction, or Joe's and Bob Martens's. Well, I'd like to be able to pass as many of these patterns, templates, technology on, because if I've got to pay a price to figure this out, I want to be able to help as many people as possible. And I'm certainly going to wind up with 100 roundels when this is done. But I hope I have figured out that, at least for me, what method, this glue's got to dry off, by the way, what method is going to work best for me. I want to press this down real good. That's one of the things I had. I didn't have enough contact cement on there the first time. Part of it is that it's so cold out there, the stuff really isn't drying well. And now I can pull out, hopefully, pull out just the sticky part if I get this right. Well, what I did, I was experimenting with the settings for the compass. So I'm going to make up a final piece of paper now with the compass settings for this, so I can go back and each time I do it, I don't want to remeasure. I want to work off settings that I already have, so that the two roundels on the bottom are exactly the same. Now this one here would be okay. I got one bad edge here. So what happens is when I take the compass up, I can't get a full swing. I'm going to have to try to do this all in one swing, which of course Ed already told me, but being I'm so cute, I'll have to figure this out again. Getting it all in one swing is an important part of it. I want to make sure maybe what's happening is this cement hasn't really set up as good as it has to. Now it seems like part of what I want to try to do is never let the compass come off the table. Just hold it down for the whole time. Off the paper. All right, still a usable cut. Seems like as you get further and further out, what happens is this knife blade is now on an angle. What it would really be nice to have is if you were going to do a lot of these, make a plywood piece where the blades were going on a 90-degree angle. See, these blades out at the perimeter
That's why I'm having a problem. Or you could make yourself a much bigger compass. The bigger compass, or don't lay it down as much. Any number of things. I guess trying to hold it straight up and down is the answer here. Anyway, a little practice. It's a good idea if you're going to buy Friskit paper. Buy a lot more than you need so you can have a little time to practice. This looks like a usable round elbow.
Okay, now to position this, what I want to do, I want to find a center point, because it's pretty obvious you need to get this some kind of a reference. I want to position this on a wing and get my center, and that'll allow me to line up the first of the circles. Now I'm going to give myself a reference line up from the trailing edge. Let's see what I have here. Now what I did, took a piece of masking tape and put two pieces of that yellow tape on it. This is just to give me an accurate reference. And this is just going to hold that down there. I know I want the back of it to be at that position, and now I need to find a position from the wing out that I want this to be on. And I know, let me just get this accurate. And then I can put a red dot out here right on center, and that lines up the round L. Now I have the center of this. I marked the center here. I also marked the templates for Joe and Bob if they want to use them. This lays out this center. Remember, this Friskit paper doesn't stick. It isn't like shelf paper or anything. So you got to kind of just baby it and seal the edge with clear, I guess, is the best way to do this. Now I need to lay out the outer circle here. Now you can see positioning this is kind of a pain in the ass because you're not going on a flat. If this was a foam wing, this would be a piece of cake, but we're going up and down hills and valleys here, and I only care about that edge. And the rest I'm going to do with tin foil and masking. I just want to tack this on without a lot of pressure. Give me some overspray control. Don't want to overpress that down. Yep, it's not exactly like pasting on decals, is it? No decals. I'm trying to put as little pressure as possible on here. But again, I don't want to get any overspray either. I'll tack that down. Okay, now I just got to repeat the same thing. All the measurements, all the cutting. You can see I've got, and this is why I try to do this on camera. You know, none of this works perfect the first time. Bullshit, yes. This just takes time. And what I did, I mentioned on this one, this is the inboard wing, so I can go back and get all my other matching circles out. I also made a little thing here, which I'll pass on to Joe and Bob Martens. And this has got all the little compass settings for the final round L's. Something that may or may not save them a little bit of time. In the meantime, I'll do the other one and get ready to spray this. May even get this sprayed today. Quick check of the temperature outside, my little local thermometer, 8 degrees. So it looks like we're going to be painting this indoors here. I'll go hang this up by the furnace room. Now luckily, we still have the white in the gun, so there's no mixing and fooling. We know we have the right mixture, pressure, and everything. It's all set to go. I'll hang it up. This will be ready to spray. By the time I get back from lunch, that'll all be...
Thank you.
of the things you got to keep in mind, I have to keep in mind, if you try to spray this, and I have done this so many times, when I used to use an airbrush, you spray on trim like this, yes, it sprays beautifully. And when you go to put tape on top of it, it pulls it right up. Now, I tried to spray this a little bit on the wet side so I'd get good adhesion. It looks like it isn't even wet enough. I like to see it where it's even wetter than this, but I'm going to have to live with this now. And I see that pulled up just a little bit. I don't know if I'm going to overspray underneath it. But I'm going to let this dry. I have to go out, get some lunch now. And the nice thing is this will be drying now. When I get back, maybe I'll hit this with one more coat of white, because I really want these to jump out, to be sparkly against the camo background or the light blue, whatever. Yeah, I give it one more coat.
Now, one thing you may want to do here, and I have no idea if you want to, but I'm going to try it, is use the masks that have the tape on one edge. I can use these over and over again now rather than make up new ones. Not really an economy move, but just something to make it more convenient since I'm going to be back masking over and over and over here.
Hey, I just went through the mail and I got these pictures from Joe Parisi. Now, Joe Parisi is one of the Australian pilots. This is obviously from the Australian, I guess what their equivalent of the Nationals. And some of the things he mentioned is Jeff Reeves here, and Brian Ether. This is, let me see if I can get this in focus. This is Brian Ether's new 60 ship. He said Brian Ether's totally off the pipe. It's totally on Super Tiger 60s now and using very low pitch prop. Well, whatever floats your boat, I guess. Hey, anyway, it looks real good. Brian's planes, needless to say, look awesome. There's a picture of Brian's plane. Really attractive paint job. Really nice. And Brian totally committed to the Tiger 60. Now, after making tune pipes for so long, totally committed to the Tiger 60, boy. Brian, we love you, baby.
Now, this is the first time I used frisket, and I see these little, it looks like the thinner in the paint has attacked the frisket a little bit here. And I'm going to try to pull that up, of course, and see just what's going on. I was not crazy about the way this frisket laid out. It was very difficult to get the corners down and everything. Of course, this is the learning experience. So what I think I'm going to do is kind of do a little test, try to reinvent it, and try to get the edges done with tape. But again, I'm going to spend a little time trying to figure this out so it suits my purposes a little.
Now, I was a little unsure. I'm still a little unsure, let's be honest about it. I was unsure about how I wanted to lay this out. You can see there's still some goop from the frisket when I pull the frisket up on this. And I'll try to get, I will get that off with M600, but this is still drying, so I want to let it sit. Now, what I did, I tried to lay out this mask, and again, we're trying to go through this together, but you can see what the story is. Almost impossible to lay that out. I think the answer would be bigger pieces of frisket. But what I did figure out how to do, and it worked really well, is I laid this piece in here. I don't know where the hell I put it. I laid this piece in, and then laid four layers of tape. One, two, three, four. And this took about, about an hour. And then I pulled the three in the middle out. So in effect, I have what I hope is a perfect circle. Again, I'm not really going to notice. This is my first trip through the Roundel maze, so to speak. The reason this is not, this doesn't work as well on these curved surfaces, it's difficult. That paper wants to wrinkle when you put it down. So it may be that I can use these patterns and then put the edges on with the tape. And it seems like the masking tape bends better than the green tape. Again, more playing and fooling around, but this looks like a doable way to do it. This will now be the yellow. I'm going to try the other one, in fact. And maybe I can get the yellow painted tonight. But, and I know everybody out there, I'm sure this happens to everybody. I'm not the only one be feeling sorry for me. Right in the middle of what I hope was going to be a whole night of building, I get the word that Uncle Herb is coming over for a visit. Oh, you can tell I'm thrilled to death, Uncle Herb. So anyway, I only have about another half hour to play here, and then we got to go do social stuff. So I'll see what I can figure this out. But this is really what's going on. It's not a cut and dry thing. It takes a little time in experimenting, and I hope you can pick up some ideas from this time that I seem to be spending. I want to see if this is going to be practical. Notice another thing. I'm doing the bottom first. The bottom. To work out all my little mistakes and things on, and let them be on the bottom. By the time I get to the top, and luckily the top of the roundels is only blue and red, probably I could use the frisket on them, but on these thin stripes, and I'll find out when Joe goes to do this and Bob Martens, they're going to be doing the same job basically. If they come up with any better idea, the frisket works almost perfect on flat surfaces, but trying to get it to bend around rib is really difficult. Well, I know when Gallagher sees this, he's going to holler at me. You don't know what the hell you're doing, Al Gallagher. Windy, you're up a mini or something. He'll have something to say anyway. Anyway, that white is still maybe a little tacky, so I ought to be a little careful here. Need to make that a little longer. And for this kind of thing, I don't want the tape to be any stickier than it has to be. I'm trying to reuse those masks as a way of just saving a little time, because there's, you know, you would think by looking at a Spitfire, oh yeah, easy paint job, yeah, paint a couple circles and that's it. Man, this is time consuming. This is really a lot of work. Actually, it's more work than even I thought it would be, and I knew it would be difficult in the beginning. Maybe you could use a brassiere to back mask this, I don't know. Hey. Alright, I'm going to mask this outside off, put a little bit of clear around the edges here, and get ready to spray some. Well, I got to do the other wing too. You know, a good point to make is anybody tells you that they were born knowing this stuff, don't believe them.
They're lying.
Life is an experiment, figuring this stuff out. Make sure you give the oil tape a little defuzzyizing. Boy, it burns my ass that this can't be a built. I can't get the whole night out of this tonight. Trick is don't have relatives. Have as few relatives as possible. At least if it's friends, you can talk about model planes, but when it's relatives, it's going to be ba 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 ba.
You still playing with model planes, Wendy?
Yeah, right. You're drunk. That's the trouble. See, all my relatives are drunks. They're all barflies. Okay, one done. Get the other one done now. You see, what I'm trying to do is I took one of the rings that doesn't have the sticky stuff off the back yet. I'm going to try this for a technique. See, this thing has to go up and down hills and around valleys and, oh man, down to the local go-go bar and everything here. Herb, I hope you know you're ruining my roundels tonight. See what happens, I get so wrapped up in Spitfires, I can't think about anything else. I can't think about relatives right now. All the while we're sitting up there bullshitting about our drunk relatives, you know, I'm going to be thinking, how can I tape off those roundels? Okay, we'll give this a try. I'm sure somebody's going to have a great idea here. Maybe they'll all feel sorry for me. Anyway, step one is I'm going to tape this off. And I can get a relatively accurate taping. Again, the way I'm doing this is just by hand. By eye, I guess is the right word. Hand, eye. And I'm going to pull that centerpiece off. Maybe this is why some people in the hobby use decals. I don't know. No, we're not using decals. Forget about it.
There will be no decals in the RAF. I'm sure that Amuska would have a sick stomach if I suggested we get these made up in Mylar or something and press them on. No press-ons here, baby. Like Pavarotti using a reverberator or something. Okay.
I remember Lou Dutka, by the way, when he made the F-16, just thinking of funny things. I looked at it and I said, hey, nice decals, Lou. Where'd you get those big decals? And he went ballistic on me. He wanted to punch me out. He was so mad. He spent 2 weeks masking off stars and bars and F-16 emblems and arrowheads. And let me tell you, Lou was one fussy builder, too. He really knew his stuff. Okay, now the deal is, I did this before in the other one, so I know it doesn't work. Get rid of this. Actually, this is the last roundel of this type. Thank God the top ones. You know what I should have done is make the bottom ones without this yellow bar. It would have saved a lot of time, but then it wouldn't have been. And you know, a guy like the Julia, he knows. He builds a Mosquito. He knows the RAF had yellow bottoms. Now this is the part, this is tricky, and this worked before. I slip this way, right up into the roundel, and then I'm peeling this straight back. Absolutely, real slow. Let's see if I can do this on camera. Real slow, and it leaves some of the gobbledygook on there. Okay. It isn't really even critical here if you pull up a little silver paint, because you're going to paint that area. This is the blue part of the roundel, but and I'll find out. Well, there goes some silver paint. I'll find out if M600 will take that right off. Okay, looks like it's coming right off. Now see, that started to rip. And if you think you're gonna do this and this kind of stuff and not have any problems to work around, forget it. People are, oh, I never have any problems. Oh, I pull the tape from drop. Yeah, sure. Okay. You know, see now, it definitely seems like the thinner in the paint attacks this. This may not be a problem when you airbrush dry, but I tried to spray these real wet. The reason for trying to spray them real wet was I want some good adhesion when tape goes over that. But it seems like, and see, this is, again, I'm sure there's more tricks. The next time you see me put something like this on video, I'll know more. The airbrushing, you don't get the thinner. Or another trick you could do is when you spray this, you could hit it with a hairdryer right away so the thinner mostly evaporated. But then you don't get that adhesion. Now it looks like, for the first time in my life, I'm getting a break here. It looks like M600 cuts right through the goop. Now I know Harold Price used to use a chemical called Subterps. And Subterps used to take the glue of the tape right off. Nice and neat. Yeah, may as well clean the whole thing up here. This little overspray here won't mean anything. That's going to get repainted. Yeah, believe it or not. So we've learned something else. M600 does take it off. Now, rather than laying this out in three pieces of 1/8, I found some 3/16 stuff. This is old tape, though. It almost has no stick to it at all. See, if you use two hands, one pushing it down and one, see, I'm walking that back and forth. You can almost get a real accurate circle anyway. And of course, you got to be able to do it left-handed too. Now I know it might be getting boring, but at some point in your
sex life or stunt life, whatever, you might want to build a Spitfire. And you might not want to be within that the group of people that buys those press-on decals. So if you are, needless to say, you'll enjoy watching me suffer. I'm sure General Champ is out there just loving every minute of this, watching me suffer alone. Now I'll put two circles of this around, mask off the inside, and then I'll just do the taping again, mask it off, and I'll be ready to go. It's funny, Karen just yelled down at me. Well, if Karen knew what I say about these guys on the tape, she just yelled down at me.
Don't forget, Herb's coming tonight. Make sure you finish up nice and early.
Boy, you hope Herb would get stuck in traffic, you know, or better yet, his car wouldn't start or something. Better yet, he'd just stop hanging out in bars and then coming over here drunk and wanting us to feed him. See, that's what's bad about having a wife that likes to cook. All the drunks in your family want to get fed once a week. Anyway, be witless anymore. Won't say any more things about bad. Bad about old Uncle Herb. But if these round bells don't come out perfect, Herb, I'll cold cock him when he walks in the door. Hey, this is really tricky, getting this tape in a perfect circle. Perfect, we don't know if it's perfect yet. Now by pulling these out, and I'll pull this tape nice and slow, I hope I'll have a perfect pattern. See, I can understand after doing this why they don't make bras out of aluminum. Aluminum foil, anyway. Boy, the things you think of out there. Spitfire brain damage here. Okay. Doesn't this look like close? Close encounters of the third time. Third kind. Close encounters of the Spitfire kind. I'm telling you, the brain is gone. Too many roundels. Ready to shoot some yellow here. Let me mix it up. And what I'm going to do, because I don't want to spend the time here, I'm kind of under the gun. I don't want to clean the gun. I'll take the white out of the gun. Just put the yellow in and get this painted before Big Herb arrives on the scene here. Okay, I changed my plan. Well, I'll tell you, it's making me crazy knowing that I have to get this done at a certain time. I hate having to work in a hurry. Anyway, taking 4 ounces of yellow, 4 ounces of thinner. I'm going to add raw pigment to it, flex oil and fisheye, pretty much the same. I won't go through this again, but for sure, extra pigment and yellow. Yellow is one of the colors that absolutely needs it every time.
When you add that extra pigment in the paint, you can see what kind of coverage you get. Now, anytime you want to paint yellow, you paint over either a silver or a gray or white base. I'm putting this on relatively dry. And it should be a one coat coverage deal. I'd like to paint Uncle Herb yellow here while I had to paint the gun. Anyway, I beat Uncle Herb tonight. Even though we're having company, I got the yellow one. Do the other roundels in the next session. One coat. Beautiful.
I see I have each jar, each color marked, what's in it. Ready to spray means it has all the fisheye and flex oil. And this is going to be critical when it comes time to do some touch-up or
who knows what. You know, I want to add another yellow stripe. I need to put the yellow bars. I guess I'll do that tomorrow, the front of the wing and the other roundels and everything. But it's, to me, it's an important thing. And when this is done, all of this touch-up paint will go in a box, and that'll be the touch-up paint for the Spitfire for all eternity.
I feel kind of good that I beat the system here tonight, even though it's, you can see it's dark out there already, freezing and dark. Anyway, I feel good. This was a good session. Let's see, I'm just trying to plan ahead here. I got another minute or two. Roundels, the leading edge bars, that'll finish up the yellow. And then finish the roundels, the blue and the red. Probably two or three more days of this kind of nonsense. And hey, it really is becoming a Spitfire, believe me. Yeah, I'm coming, crying out loud. Give me a break.
Alright, this looks like it dried up real nice. It's good.
The difficulty with laying out the side roundels is I need to match it up. So I put what I thought was an estimated center here. And needless to say, this is going to be adjusted many times. If I can just lay these circles on here, just roughly, ever so roughly. I'm using my layout piece just to check where the real center of this is. Now I laid this circle out leaving about a 1/16 of an inch clearance because I'm not using those outward roundel friskets. Just using the inner one. I had that tape just holding it in place. Now you can see what the problem is I'm not on center. This allows me to see just where the center this is. So I'm going to have to move this center down and in this direction. This gets a little tricky because you're always trying to find a reference. Now, if we could use all these, yeah, that would be great, but I haven't been able to do that yet. I can pull these off. Obviously, we're going to save them. I'm going to save this one. But the fine dead center, just by eye here, I can see that I have to go down and in this direction. If I don't line up the edge and then line up the middle, the rest of them will be wrong. I'm not so crazy about that either, but let's just see. Still too far. After moving it about 2,200 times, you finally arrive at what you hope is going to be the center. Now I want to lay out the other piece of tape, the third piece, and pull a middle piece off. Pretty much the same as we figured out the yellow band on the other roundels. Now maybe these camera angles won't really be good. Obviously I can't look into the lens, have this on my lap, but this is the only way I can figure out to make this reasonable. If I had somebody over here today, but that's not going to happen either. And I guess one of the things, you know, when you're working alone like this, you always have to plan how are you going to do things that would be 1,000 times easier if you had two people, but you don't have two people. Okay, now I'm going to put the 1/8 inch on the inside. You'd be surprised, you do enough of this. You'll get reasonable with it. No reason to be intimidated here. This is just
Boy, I wish that frisket, if you could lay it out over flat surfaces, boy, would it be nice. The minute you have to go around a curve, though, be aware. It's to be a nuisance. But anyway, now I just want to check that I have this centerpiece accurate. I've got enough reference lines here to choke a horse. Check it in three or four different spots. Adjust it if necessary. It's a little high. Yeah, it needs to be lowered by just a little bit. And I think I'll have it. Of course, I've said that before. See, the way I know I have that little dot in the center, I'm referencing off of that dot. Again, no matter what shape trim you use, you have to be able to reference off something. Oh, yes. Even Adam Muska would be impressed with that. Now, the last step is, and I really hope this is staying in focus and I'm not wandering around, but is to just try to lay this down. Lay out this ring. Now, it would be a lot easier to use this ring than it would be to have to mask off something with this small of a radius, so I'm hoping I'm going to be, that laid right out. Hope of hopes is that I can use this. Okay, and then the last thing, hold the tape.
I'll tell you what a pain it is.
This is really turning out to be a lot of work. But then everything, building the Colosseum in Rome was probably a lot of work too. Imagine masking off all those Romans and everything. Okay, now we will be using that line. I want to save the white line. That's the only reason I'm putting this little tape on here. And again, next step is, of course, going to mask this all off with foil and try to get this yellow painted. While this is drying, I can work on those wing bars. That's going to be it for this session. I'll let that dry. This took longer than I thought it would too. Tomorrow I'll come back here and then I can start on. I was going to try to do my wing bars, that yellow stripe that goes out here. Sometimes you just run out of time. Now let that sit by the heating vent overnight and should just about do it. Morning will be ready to go again. It looks like this is really dried up nicely today. I'm going to pull off all the mask. And then I guess the next thing, see I'm trying to do this logically, the next thing while I have the yellow and the gun would be to get the bars on the leading edge of the ring done. Try to do this systematically, of course. Just about at the end of this tape, and I don't want to end it in the middle of one of our sequences, so I'll start the rest of the other bars on the next tape. But I really hope that you've been enjoying sharing this with us, and there certainly are enough people in the RAF right now, you know, getting involved in this, sharing things, sharing photos, pictures, videos. I'm sure once the plane actually gets in the air, it'll generate even more excitement. It's certainly generated enough excitement in my family here for Uncle Herb. I gave him a little hint. The hint was, you know, take a hike until the Spitfire is done. He didn't get it, though. Anyway, this is just a good time to just look around. One of those little watersheds that we always hit along the way, and I don't know about you, but I sit around and I think about this and look at it from different angles and try to think of some even more trim that I can put on it, or something fancy, or give Adamusco some ideas, or whatever. I hope that information that we worked out with the roundels over there will be of some value if you decide to ever do this. But again, there's no substitute for experimenting and find out what works for you the best. That's always my first choice. And thanks a lot to everybody that contributed. Ed Gallagher in particular on this video was instrumental with all the stuff he sent us. I really do appreciate it. Thanks to everybody.
And it seems like every time I think I've thanked everybody enough for everything, I look around my shop, and my bathroom even, and see this, hey, I like that nose art. Look at the books, the things that everybody's contributed into this project, and I realize just how special it really is. And it wouldn't be special if we all lived on little desert islands and kept to ourselves, or got all caught up in who was winning what award for who, when, where, and we just lost our appreciation of the event itself. You know, I think that's something for me to think about anyway, is the friendships certainly outweigh the awards by about a million to one here. And just looking around, every time I sit in this bathroom and look at these things Champ's in, and I just keep thinking, oh man, more Spitfires, more ideas, more things. And this will give me something to think about while I lay out the program for the next tape. So thanks for joining us. We'll see you on the next tape. One of the sayings I have hanging in my shop, and I try never to forget it. It really is a significant thing.